What's up, guys? It's time for another XEB Plus Neutrino Launcher update. As always, there's a playlist you can go watch if you want the full backstory. But this time, I'm actually going to recommend that you watch a specific video from that playlist if you haven't seen it yet. Reason being is that that video establishes concepts and has a lot of information that's going to become relevant later on in this video. A link to that should be on screen now. Now, I recently got a Memcard Pro 2, which I reviewed in my last video. This time, I'm going to talk about how I added support for it and other smart memory cards to the XEB Plus Neutrino Launcher plugin. Support for MMCE loading was added to Neutrino not too long ago, so the first thing I did upon getting my Memcard Pro 2 was add an MMCE launcher to the plugin. That's been released for a little while now, but I only announced it in a YouTube short, so you may not have seen it. The setup process for MMCE devices is pretty much the same as MX4SIO. Just copy your games to the SD card and run the list builder. You should also make sure that your device has the latest firmware, or else it may not support MMCE loading. One thing to be aware of is that the virtual memory cards created by the list builder are not the same as those created by smart memory cards. So, if you create VMCs during setup, you can end up with multiple VMC files for the same game in different locations on the same SD card. Once your list has been built, just put the SD card in your MMCE device, plug it into memory card slot 1 on the PlayStation 2, and you should be able to run games with the Neutrino MMCE launcher. Now, I've heard rumors going around that MMCE has poor compatibility and isn't worth it compared to other options. I don't think that's the case, though. While I haven't done extensive testing, every game I have tried with MMCE thus far has worked great. The load times are noticeably faster than MX4SIO, which, if anything, should improve compatibility. If there are problems, though, that's what the Neutrino compatibility list is for. Go add the games you've played to it so that developers can verify and fix any issues. Speaking of the compatibility list, people have not been filling out their game entries completely when they add to it. I recently added a column for the Fix Buffer Overrun setting, which is a new compatibility flag in Neutrino. The question mark you see in this column for nearly every game indicates that that game was tested on a version of Neutrino that did not have this flag. However, several people have submitted new entries with a question mark in the Fix Buffer Overrun column even after that setting was added to both Neutrino and the plugin. In future, please make note of that setting in your submissions and update your version of the Neutrino launcher if necessary. Alright, now for the fun part. The big new feature of the Neutrino launcher update that's releasing alongside this video is support for game ID detection on smart memory cards. This is done by taking advantage of an official feature of the PS2 that most people don't know about, called the history file. The way this works is that every time the PlayStation 2 launches a disk or hard drive application that has a title ID, that ID, along with some metadata, gets written to a small file on the memory card in slot 1. Now, you may have heard that the boxes you see during the PS2 startup animation are determined by the contents of your memory card. But that's actually a misconception. It's really the entries in your history file that determine the arrangement of boxes you get on startup. And that is the only thing that this file was ever used for officially. Hackers and homebrew developers have gotten way more utility out of the PS2 history file than Sony ever did. In case you haven't already guessed, the history file is how smart memory cards figure out what game you're playing. Up until now, the XEB Plus Neutrino launcher hasn't had code to write to the history file, so it just doesn't get updated when you launch a game. In order to add that code, I first had to understand how the history file was constructed, and that's where things get a bit tricky. This is what a single entry in the history file looks like. The whole file is just a series of these entries written back to back. There's no header or anything like that to worry about. If we focus on just one entry, most of it is pretty self-explanatory. We can take this first string of bytes and decode them into ASCII to get a PlayStation 2 title ID. The 5 bytes that follow are used as padding, so they're always set to 0. This last chunk is the metadata and contains several different values. You can probably already tell that this data format is over-engineered for how it ultimately wound up getting used. It's clear that whoever designed this had plans for the history file that went well beyond the boot animation, something that becomes all the more apparent when we start digging into that metadata. The first byte of the metadata sequence is the play count. This is just an 8-bit unsigned integer that gets incremented by 1 every time a game is launched, though this value will never go beyond 63. The next two bytes are a bit of a mystery. I know what they are, but I don't know exactly what they do. A comment in the OPL source code seems to indicate that whoever reverse engineered this format doesn't actually know what these bytes are used for. That comment, by the way, is basically the only information that exists on the inner workings of the history file. There is a PS2 History Tweaker app, which is very useful for observing how these values behave in relation to each other, but that program has no written documentation, and the source code comments are much less detailed than those in OPL. What I do know for certain is that the second metadata byte is a bit mask, and the third is an offset value. These two bytes are initialized to 1 and 0 respectively, where they remain until the play count reaches 14. Once that happens, a new offset value is procedurally generated using this algorithm, and that value is then used to calculate a new bit mask. After that, these two values are updated via the same method on every 10th launch, and this continues until the play count maxes out. Now, I could sit here and speculate about what all this is meant to accomplish, but I truly do not know, and I'm not sure that anyone else does either, so I'm just gonna move on. The next byte in this sequence is more padding, and that just leaves the last two bytes, which are a date code that stores when the game was last played. The date code format used here is a slightly modified version of the DOS date code that goes back to the early 80s. This encoding manages to squeeze the day, month, and year into just two bytes. Unfortunately, that makes it nigh incomprehensible when written in hexadecimal. We have to expand this value out into binary to make any sense of it, and even then, I'm not sure I fully understand what's going on here. Thankfully, this encoding is very well documented, and there are plenty of code samples to reference for how to read and write dates in this format. So, that's the makeup of a single history file entry, but there's some additional logic that governs how new entries are appended to the list, and when old entries get moved to the history.old file, which is also a whole thing. Fortunately, I don't need to worry about any of that in order to implement title ID detection in the Neutrino launcher. In fact, I don't need to worry about any of this metadata crap. The history file only needs a single entry for this use case, and the only part of that entry that matters is the title ID. So I've decided to cheat a bit. Instead of doing all the calculations for the metadata and appending new entries to the list, my implementation just overwrites the existing history file with a new one containing a single entry. That entry consists of the current game's title ID, appended with a hard-coded string consisting of padding and same defaults for all the metadata values. Obviously, this implementation wipes out any previous history file that was on the memory card, but as far as I know, the only side effect of doing that is that the PS2 startup animation will look like this every time. Not that anyone is likely to notice, because FreeMcBoot and PS2 BBL both skip over the startup animation, and you need one of those installed to use XEB Plus in the first place. Adding all the functionality required to update the history file properly would take a ton of time and effort, and add extra bloat to my already disorganized codebase. All for a feature that only the most hardcore of purists are going to care about. If you are that sort of purist, though, worry not. I have at least made sure that the old history file gets backed up if it contains more than one entry. So you can always go and restore your history file from before using the plugin if you really want to. Now, I hope you all went and watched that video I told you to earlier, because it's about to become relevant. If you did, then you already know all about memory card groups and why they exist. But there's something I did when defining those groups that I didn't draw attention to before. If you look on the wiki, you'll see that each group has been assigned an ID that begins with the prefix XEBP and looks suspiciously like a PlayStation 2 title ID. This is the group ID, and it gets written to the history file in place of the regular title ID for any game that's been assigned to a memory card group, thereby duplicating the functionality I created for Neutrino's VMCs on smart memory cards. This happens regardless of whether or not you created VMC files during setup, and just like with the built-in VMCs, you can override the grouping behavior by selecting Use Unique VMC in the launch options. When the Memcard Pro 2 is using a group VMC, it will display the group ID instead of the game title like it usually would. There is one minor limitation with this, however. You may recall how two of the groups I defined require a 32 MB memory card image to fit all the data. Well, unfortunately, there's no way to specify a memory card size when passing the title ID in through the history file, so you might run out of room if you play multiple titles in either of these two groups. Theoretically, one of the padding bytes in the history file could be repurposed to specify a memory card size, but that would require modifying the Memcard Pro 2's firmware, which I would gladly do, but like I said previously, I don't have access to the source code. Actually, if I did have the source code, I could probably just add this grouping feature directly into the firmware itself. Then it would just work with any software that updates the history file. I could also add these group IDs to whatever database it's using, and give them all unique names to show on screen. I am seriously kicking myself for getting a Memcard Pro 2 instead of an SD to PSX. Is what I was going to say, but since I originally recorded this, one of my channel members who goes by Finn McCool has gotten in touch with me in order to single-handedly fund my purchase of a PSX Memcard Gen 2. That has been ordered and is currently on its way, so hopefully I'll be releasing updates to the SD to PSX firmware somewhere down the line. Huge thank you to Finn for making that happen, and if you'd like to join him in supporting these types of projects, I have a channel membership you can join linked in the description. With that, I think I'm finally done talking about memory cards, so let's go over the other changes made in this update. The first thing is that the plugin now uses a custom fork of Cheat Device that's designed to better integrate with the Neutrino launcher. I've reskinned it to match the XEB Plus interface, but this fork could theoretically be integrated into any Neutrino front end. The main change I made was replacing all those ugly file paths in the launch menu with sensibly labeled options. I also removed the option to launch a disk, along with a number of other features that just don't make sense to have with the way it's being used here. Overall, I think these changes make for a much better user experience. Other than that, I've cleaned up a few bugs, one of which involved completely rewriting the code that scrolls the list. That was a lot of work, but the menu scrolling is now more responsive. Also, it turns out that the routine that unloads all the plugin's graphics when it closes wasn't properly implemented this whole time. Oops. So anyway, that's been fixed, and now the system doesn't crash when you close and reopen Neutrino Launcher multiple times. So there's been a last minute update. As I was editing this video, Neutrino version 1.6 released, which means this video had to be delayed in order to add support for it. This version of Neutrino adds more G.S.M options, so I've had to go back and rework the menu to accommodate them. In the process, I also ended up refactoring a bunch of other code, and now the navigation controls are slightly different. So let me go over everything real quick. To start with, the L1 and R1 buttons no longer quick scroll through the list. That is now exclusive to the L2 and R2 buttons, and the scrolling is both faster and more precise than it was before. The L1 and R1 buttons now change the list, so you can cycle between the main list, recent games, and favorites in either direction. The triangle button, which was used to cycle the list previously, now adds or removes the current game from the favorites list. The Add to Favorites option has also been removed from the context menu. In the context menu, there are now three different GSM options. The first one toggles progressive scan on or off, the second one forces a 240-line vertical resolution, and you can choose between either native 240p or line-doubled 480p. The third and final option lets you cycle between three different field flipping modes, which can improve GSM compatibility with certain titles. These changes have rendered the GSM compatibility page on the wiki completely obsolete, so I've wiped all the existing entries and updated it to reflect the new settings. Apologies to anyone who contributed to that page previously. As always, links to everything are in the description. Be sure to subscribe to this channel if you want to see more updates, and I will see you guys later.